celebrate Dorothy. We're going to have prayer. We're going to have some of her preferred music, some of her favorite music. We're going to have a word from Alex. We're going to pray some more. And we're going to celebrate her life. So thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for the love that has gone into this day. Just meeting the family, I know that Dorothy is a beloved member of the family, and I just feel it in the room today. So hear these words. Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Dorothy put on Christ, so in Christ may Dorothy be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we are gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate Dorothy Sewell. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace, that in pain we find comfort, in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. Now hear this song, the first of her favorites, I believe. I have to get it. When's the last time you heard Maggie May in church? So as we progress today, if you have a memory or a story that comes to your mind that you think you might like to share, there's going to be a time a little bit later in the service where I'm going to invite you to come up and do that. So keep that in mind. That'll be just a little bit later. But for now, let's pray together. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, and when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Another song. Another one you may not have heard in church.
It's not time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to know. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. I was once like you are now, and I know that it's not easy to be calm when you found something going on. But take your time, think a lot. Think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not. How can I try to explain? When I do, he turns away again. It's always been the same, same old story.
Now
hear these words, these comforting words from our scripture, the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I want to read to you something that Dorothy had marked in her Bible. It is Luke 6, verses 32 to 38. These verses were important to Dorothy, so much so that she marked them. So it'd be good for us to listen. If you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? Even sinners love those who love them, and if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money to those who can repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for full return. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward from heaven will be very great. And you'll truly be acting as children of the Most High, for he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You must be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Give, and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back. And our gospel lesson today is from Luke, also Luke chapter 24, and it's verses 13 through 35. It's a very familiar story. Let's see, beginning in verse 13. It's the walk to Emmaus. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. And as they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them, but God kept them from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing so intently as you walk along?" They stopped short. Sadness was written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, "You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard all the things that has happened here the last few days." "What things?" Jesus asked. "The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth," they said. "He was a prophet who did powerful miracles and was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and the other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. When we had hoped that he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel, this all happened 3 days ago. Then some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing and that they had seen an angel who told them that Jesus is alive. Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. Then Jesus said to them, 'You foolish people, you find it so hard to believe that all that the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering into his glory?' Then Jesus took them through all the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself." By this time, they were nearing Emmaus and the end of their journey. Jesus acted as if he were going to go on, but they begged him to stay. "Stay the night with us, since it is getting late." So he went home with them. As they sat down to eat, he took bread and blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. Suddenly their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. This is the word of the Lord. From what I understand, Dorothy was a pretty hip lady. You can pick up on that. I was picking up on that when I got the selections for the music. We're going to play some Maggie May in church. And she also loved to travel. I know that. She every continent, from what I understand, she was on, and every state in the United States she's visited. Avid boaters. They once piloted their boat, the Steady Stream, to Rochester, New York. That's pretty impressive. And I love the name of that boat, given the profession of dock. I was told that Dorothy earned a PhD. PhD, if you ever heard that, is put him through to get his education. Dorothy is all about family, all about those important relationships. That where those bonds, those important bonds are created, where wisdom is shared and handed down. Today is a mix of joy and sadness as we say goodbye to someone like Dorothy. It's always a mix because she lived life so well. We celebrate all that she was and all that she is. At the same time, we realize that there will be no more boat trips. We know that there's no more visits with the dog. The last conversation that was had will be the last ones that we remember. Things left undone will have to remain that way. Something that I understand Dorothy once said, I don't know how often, but she said that to do it on Wednesday and don't mess up my weekend. Is that a common thing that she said? Okay. Dorothy left us on a Wednesday, so she wouldn't mess up our weekend. We don't always see what's around us. We don't always appreciate what's around us. Sometimes we don't know what we have until it's gone. In the gospel lesson I read a few minutes ago, those two people were walking along the road to Emmaus. And they knew about Jesus, they knew who Jesus was, and they knew presumably about the scriptures, and yet they had lost hope. But then as Jesus walked with them through the scripture about all that had happened in relation to him, they started to understand intellectually. They understood and they were moved, and they were even inspired because they wanted him to spend the night with them. But it wasn't until Jesus broke the bread that they clearly saw who he was. The relationship went from an intellectual one to a heart one. There's nothing like a shared meal together. There's nothing like sharing a life together. And that's what Dorothy did. She shared her life. I can tell you that Dorothy was a wonderful person with plenty of evidence to support that. But that doesn't even come close to knowing and experiencing and loving Dorothy. I didn't get that experience, but I feel that it all that from you. You have had the privilege of knowing Dorothy with your heart. It was immediately after they recognized Jesus that Jesus was gone. Yes, Dorothy is gone from our sight today, but we don't have to say goodbye forever. Dorothy has entered into life triumphant and is at rest until the age to come. That's the promise of the faith. Jesus came to give us life, and Jesus came to give us life in abundance. So praise to Jesus for our salvation. Praise be to Jesus for Dorothy's salvation. May we all come to such faith that we can see Jesus and those around us with that same heart knowledge. That this life is a miracle, that this life is precious, that this life is something to be celebrated. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, help us to keep our hearts open to each other. Help us to live the way that our loved ones taught us. Help us to live and to embrace life the way Dorothy did. And Lord God, we thank you so much for her life. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite, Alex was supposed to be here, and he was going to give a message, but unfortunately, his flight was canceled, and he's just stuck. So what he did was he recorded a message for us, and so we're going to play that so that he can be here. Is this hit play? All right, so here is Alex.
1945, Denby High School in Detroit. Last day of school. Grandma was a cheerleader, you know. And well, Grandma told me the girls would wear the guys' varsity sweaters, not jackets, and the swim team wore wool, if they wore anything at all. One thing hasn't changed, the ceremonial signing of the yearbooks. And I remember looking at Grandma's, and the well wishes from the classmates were pretty consistent. Dear Dorothy, you're a swell gal. Dorothy, you sure are swell. Dearest Dot, it's been a swell year with a swell gal like you. Keep swell and carry on. Dorothy, you're the swellest gal I know. Dorothy was swell. Everyone sitting here knew it. We don't say swell anymore, but we know what it means. Excellent. And Dorothy, nay, Clark, was so swell she married a Sewell. She only needed another E to make it her permanent nomenclature. And yeah, she was the swellest, most excellent grandma anyone could ask for. The swellest wife, swellest mother, swellest sister, daughter, cousin, mother-in-law, great-grandmother, forever embodying the swell in Sewell before the swell gal was a Sewell. And when my dad had to relocate from Colorado to Michigan for work, what a monumental opportunity to have his kids be raised around such an effervescent woman. A symbolic swell matriarch at a stone's throw. And when we lost my mother far too early, that swell symbol and all of the Sewells stepped up in an unthinkable time, in such a natural way, and it shaped my life forever. And Grandma was there, right there to carry on the legacy
of my own mother. And she had such a hand in shaping us. And we know what they say about grandparents. They spoil their grandkids in a way, sorry, aunts and uncles, that they would never with their own kids. Dorothy didn't spoil anyone. We know that. She enriched us. She and Grandpa taught us about joie de vivre, a way of enjoying life, an attitude to have, a way of living, of being. Nothing was monetary, it was active. And it was all encompassing. She was enriching us with experiences, with activity, with the very things she shared with her own kids and the things she experienced herself. And let's talk about that. Grandma was simple. Contextually, we hear the word simple. And sometimes there's a negative connotation, but it took me to about the age of 30 to understand that simplicity is enviable. Leonardo da Vinci said, simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. Yes, Dorothy Jane Clark was so simple, that she was one of the first tourists to enter the People's Republic of China when it opened to the Western world. She was so simple. She spoke about how the Chinese people, many who had never seen a Westerner before, would approach the Americans and marvel at their hair, going so far as to touch it or pick at it. Grandma was so simple, she went to Soviet Russia. She was so simple, she knew how to warn her husband not to wear shorts in Argentina and what that meant, and not to bring her jewelry to Brazil, though I think she did anyway. Grandma was so simple, she could live on a boat for weeks at a time, dragging the dishes in a net to clean them. She could sail with her family in the Caribbean or find a taxidermist to preserve a swordfish her husband helped catch deep sea fishing in Palm Beach to preserve it forever. So simple, right? A simple woman travels to all seven continents, using those simple skilled sea legs to stand up in the Antarctic waters. Grandma was so simple. Remember, I'm saying simple in lieu of sophisticated, like Da Vinci. She knew to put Sandy, her water poodle, who was going bald, on Rogaine when his hair started falling out. Sophisticated. And this simple woman designed her homes to her family's lifestyle. With a dark room to develop the family photos in the basement, or to put a swing smack dab in the middle of her living room for her grandkids to play on. There was always a workshop for Grandpa, a hill for sledding, kiwi bushes, raspberry bushes, or lofted ceilings where the radio that was always on could echo throughout the home. The homes were always by the water, because in Michigan, water has two purposes, swimming every day, and in the summer, and ice skating in the winter. And a simple woman has simple hobbies, right? Swimming, ice skating. She told me she fell into the ice one year, and she got right back up and on the ice. Boating, bowling, sewing, shout out to McCall's Patterns. Cross-country skiing. She wrote shorthand. She baked. She read books. She listened to books. She discovered our interests and promoted them, getting us magazine subscriptions or calendars about what we liked. And she wasn't the gossip, but she always had the newest People magazine, or Boater's World, or Medical Journal for Grandpa. I remember being at a dinner party with friends, some old, some new, and in a moment of silence, of getting to know one another, I just blurted out, did anyone else build miniature dollhouse furniture when they were little? That's all Grandma and Grandpa. If we could do it, we did it. We did it with them. Origami, rug weaving. Remember the rugs. The rugs we made. Boat knots, fishing, grilled cheese making, bird watching, nature trail hiking, horseback riding. We did it all. We were simple kids. And Grandma was a simple woman who never stopped learning, never stopped swimming. She had high-speed internet before we did. She figured out the poodle emoji before the millennials and was texting before my parents. My parents still can't text. She might have had always the newest Bose speakers before anyone in Michigan. She wore Skechers and had a sport sacks, but looked damn good in a fur coat too. A simple mink for a swell gal. And yet, as my sister said, she was always seemingly in a bathing suit with perfectly freshly painted nails. And let's not forget where a simple woman comes from. Australia, the House of David. If you don't know, you can ask any of us after, but the Clarks came from Australia to Benton Harbor. There's a book about it. And the last time I saw Grandma this past December, I said, "Gram, this is fascinating. Can I have this book?" Her response, "No, get your own copy." The fighting spirit of my then 95-year-old, simple, sophisticated grandmother. Well, I did get a copy, and I found out Edith Clark was one of the heroic women to come after the unsavory leader in Benton Harbor. This heroism that still flows in the bloodline. Grandma was sweet. I have a metaphor coming. There was always dessert. Always something sweet. Can of soda and honey roasted peanuts in the afternoon. Angel food cake with chocolate icing after dinner. Fruit jello with the little marshmallows on special occasions. Vienna wafers. The Dairy Queen on Orchard Lake Road. Even on the boat we had ice cream. Ice cream after everything. Beautiful dinner, sweet endings. And sweet Grandma always had a smile on her face. She never cursed. She never complained. My goodness, the most I can ever recall being upset with her was when I didn't have sneakers to wear to a birthday party, and she gave me an old pair from the 1970s she had lying around the house. And I was so embarrassed. Now, in hindsight, what I didn't know was how stylish the sneakers were and how on-trend it was to wear retro clothing. So I was mad that she was making me stylish, and that's the most upset I've ever been with her? It's pretty remarkable. A few years ago, I was unexpectedly in Michigan, and I told no one, so I thought I would surprise Grandma and take her to lunch. So I drove to her place. I rang the doorbell. She wasn't home. I called her. She didn't pick up. I waited. Then I got the call back. "Hey, Grandma." "Oh, hey, Al. How's it going?" "Good. What are you up to?" "Oh, I was just at the pool. That's why I didn't have my phone." "What do you say I take you to lunch?" When she realized what was going on, I greeted her at home, and I realized I had my dad's truck, and it was snowy. And I'm a New Yorker, and I hate driving. And Grandma said, "Oh, I'll drive. I know a great lunch club nearby." Yep, Grandma took a swim class and then hit the road in the snow and sleet, and I profusely apologized. And she said, "Al, honestly, I'm glad you surprised me. Now I have you all to myself." Grandma always said, "I want your presence, not your presence." I'll say that again. Grandma always said, "I want your presence, not your presence." And we spoke about Grandma being swell, simple, sweet. I know we're looking for another S, but gee, she put the great in grandmother. She put the grand in grandmother. In 1998, she gave my sister an aspirin that expired in 1986. No, wait a minute. That was actually a joke from a different draft of this speech. Let me begin that again. In 1998, Tom Brokaw wrote a book called The Greatest Generation. I know about it because WJR was always on at Graham and Graham's, and that is something demographically speaking that would be covered on WJR. I also knew she read it, the hardcover version, from the library. The Greatest Generation is defined by those born between 1901 and 1927. Grandma was born in 1926. This great woman, this great grandmother, and this grandmother was part of the Greatest Generation. It shaped her, it shaped me, and it shaped us. In a few years, the only survivors of the Greatest Generation will be centenarians. We are so lucky. We are so blessed to have been in the presence of someone of that generation, and for more reasons than we may well know. The Greatest Generation experienced so much and seemingly had less. But back then, less really was more. Jane, Nip, George, Sally, the four swell Sewells with the great mother. You are so fortunate to have had your mother and have her with you for all of this time. Dennis, Tracy, Madison, and I were fortunate too. We have all been fortunate to have this great woman in our lives for so long, to absorb the memories. And a photo in a yearbook from Denby High School, or a photo collage all developed at 5930 Franklin Road in the darkroom, these images are physical memories. We can take the picture, but it's not the pictures we will remember. None of it is physical. Sugarloaf, where we went skiing, can be demolished. In fact, it was. Babalo, where we rode roller coasters and saw Crystal Gale perform, can close and turn into a private island, but we will hold on to the memories there. The memories with her. These are intangible items. Our memory of Dorothy will always remain. Great, sweet, simple, swell. Dorothy Jane Sewell, you will be remembered, you are remembered, and we celebrate the life that you lived. Thank you, everybody.
Is there anyone that would like to share a memory or a story? Yeah. Yeah, it's tough. Not getting any takers? Think about it for a second. Anybody? Yeah, come on up. Okay. Well, they won't be able to hear you online if you didn't. Okay.
Hi, I just want to say a couple of things. I haven't known Dorothy. I didn't know Dorothy for a long time, but she was a mentor for me on how to live a life and how to age. She was like the coolest older person I ever met. And my little story is, it probably was about 10 years ago. The date's kind of compressed, but it was a while back. And our pond froze, And there's Dorothy shoveling the snow off the pond so she could ice skate. And I just couldn't believe it. I mean, here's a woman who was like my mom's age, and she's out in the middle of winter ice skating on the pond. And I just thought, pardon?
With her racing skates.
Yeah. I just thought that was so cool. And she was always, I just looked at her as an example on how to live a life, always a smile, never a sour word. She was great. Thank you.
Who else? There must be more. You're thinking maybe I should, maybe shouldn't. Yeah, let's hear. Anything? Yeah, come, please, come on up.
I'm Pamela Griffin. I've lived in Dorothy's neighborhood about 5 years. In the first year that we moved in, it was snowing sideways. We probably had about 6 inches of snow, and I was just getting my husband, who's handicapped, up, so I'm looking out his window, and here comes this little tiny woman, all bundled up, with her Elmer Fudd hat on, and she's got Abby with her, this beautiful poodle who's about half her size. And I said to my husband, "Wow, look at there. There's somebody going for a walk." And he's like, "Yeah, it's like 10 below and it's, you know, snowing sideways." There went Dorothy. But I guess that would have been just operation normal for Dorothy from what I've learned. But she was a wonderful lady and we just really enjoyed her. And we're going to miss her. But what an example she set for all of us to live our lives to the fullest. So those are my memories.
So I probably have a lot of Sewell stories, but I don't know if we have enough time for all of them, but I did want to say that, you know, I was pretty privileged to grow up in this area, and it was kind of a gem of a childhood I had, but I really had jewels for neighbors, and that's my Sewell story mostly. It's kind of wrapped up, it's a little short, but really, my whole family, I'm sure, feels the same way, and we've always loved you guys, and you're even in my, you know, internet passwords.
They said the roof was going to fall in. My brother Timmy stole the podium last time. I'm farmer Mark Caverly. I first met the Sewells, 69, 70, 71. A buddy of mine was chasing Sally. He had to go over here about every other day. So I was always driving with him. And I got a couple other stories about Mrs. Sewell. And it was Mrs. Sewell. She had an ear for the tin on the cookie jar. And she had a limit of 2 cookies per day. And that was it. There was TV time, I think it was 20 minutes, maybe 22 minutes. And don't violate the TV rules. Don't violate any of the rules. They had about 5 acres up here, up the road up here. And Nep was the instigator. She could be anywhere and had 5 acres, and the second that he pulled the lid off of that cookie jar, Norman, in the time that it took her to call out Norman 3 times, he took 5 more cookies. And if you weren't there, you know, to see it, it was a classic. The Jewish were next door. You know, I got thousands and thousands of stories. The very first time we went to Florida on a vacation, I'd never been anywhere. I hadn't been past Toledo, you know. So they invited me down to Florida. Mrs. Sewell's mother and father were down in Leesburg. And I don't know how many years they went down there, but they always went to Lake Griffin. This particular year, there was 8 or 10 of us outsiders who went down there. McKellars and this, that, and the other thing. I think my brother. And I didn't have a clue where I was. I think my brother Timmy was driving. He had one of them Volkswagen Beetles. And, you know, we got about $6 together to try and get down there. We got down there about $3 worth of gas. And we got down there about a day ahead of the Sewells. And I think Pam was down there too. So we didn't have a clue what was going on. We found this Lake Griffin place, and I guess we found where they were staying, but we couldn't get in there because the Sewells weren't there yet. And they were king of the castles. They always hauled a speedboat with them and everything else. So my brother and I stole a couple of inner tubes. And the genius idea was we're gonna tie a six pack to each inner tube, put it in the water to keep cool, and we're gonna take a little rest because we just drove straight through. I stayed in bed for 7 days straight with a severe sunburn. So I missed the whole damn trip. All of it. But that's the kind of fun we all had. And, you know, the other story, I got thousands, but one of the first times I met Mrs. Sewell, I hadn't known these guys very long, and I had a Z28 that went pretty fast. And that was like a 69 Z28 with a lot of horsepower. And it's kind of a classic because I just took a Z28 over to Mrs. Sewell's last year, and I tried getting her in the car, and she wouldn't ride with me. So, I'll wait, you know, but that's pretty fast too. So anyway, I'm racing down the road, Walnut Lake Road, Franklin, something else, and I know I'm doing 150 or 60 miles an hour, and Bloomfield Township, I see some lights behind me. It's not the first time I tried doing something like that, you know. So I go, shit, where am I going, man? Holy shit. So now these cops are getting closer and closer, and I'm 16, and I go, man, there's this house up here in the corner. Man, I'm just gonna wheel right in there. I don't even know them, but man, I'm just gonna like try and hide because they had a back garage and a front garage. They had two driveways over here at Sewell's house. So they had one back around the back that you could probably hide. So I go wheeling in there. I mean, I'm pulling a four-wheel drift. He has skid marks for, you know, a quarter of a mile and everything else. And the car, it makes quite a bit of noise. I had open headers and all that kind of stuff. So the garage door was open, and I don't even know how I got it in the garage without smashing the garage. But so I wheeled this car, you know, sideways in the garage. Mrs. Sewell standing in the garage. She closed the garage door as fast as she possibly could. 30 seconds later, the cops pulling in the driveway, she kicked them out. She goes, what are you boys doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? Well, we're looking for this orange car with stripes that's going like really fast. Well, don't look here at my house. And she goes, yeah, she kicked him out. And I got thousands of stories like that.
All right. Anybody else? Anybody else? Oh, okay.
Hello, I'm Linda Patelka, and I too have a lot of soul stories. But having said that, not nearly as many as Farmer. But I met the Sewells a long time ago, inadvertently, because I was kind of dating someone Jane was dating, and my sister was kind of dating someone that Patty was dating. And so we started stalking the Sewells and driving by their house all the time to see if our errant boyfriends were over there visiting the really fun swell Sewells. So it all started kind of innocently there. And then I got encouraged to ask George out to take me to a wedding. And George and I started dating. And then I got into the swell Sewell clan. And then after that, kind of all hell broke loose. And I will kindly just say, I have modeled my life as much as I can after Dorothy with my own son, because he's a lot like Farmer. And the cops were always chasing him, and I was always hiding his crap in the garage and saying, I don't know what you're talking about. But the Sewells and Dorothy and Doc, they were a big part of my life, because I've been a big part of the Sewells' life. And they taught me about boating and living simply as much as we can and trying to stop and smell the roses along the way. And I certainly cherish Dot's memory, because she was always just, like she said, seemed always to be in the bathing suit or wearing the skates somehow. But I remember it was just always, we always watched hockey in the house with the limited time that we had. The hockey game was on, right? So it was always fun, and she's a wonderful lady and a treasure for sure, and you guys were all so lucky to have her for so long.
Oh, you're not coming up this way? Okay. Anybody else? Anybody else? Excuse me. Would you pray with me? God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us with, even to this day, for the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, for our baptism and our place in church, with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. As he taught us, now we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And one more song that you probably won't ever hear again in church. It's a little Billy Joel.
I'm in a New York state of mind. I've seen all the movie stars and their time. I'm in a New York state of mind. It was so easy living day by day. Out of touch with the rhythm and blues. But now I need a little give and take. The New York Times, the Daily News. Slide. Don't care if it's Chinatown or Rotten Riverside. I don't have any reason left there far behind. I'm in a New York state of mind. I'm in a New York state of mind.
Now receive this blessing with benediction. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. And of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, the blessing of God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.